is Alert closing the gap. And on to me. This is outnumbered, by the way. And that was Harris Faulkner. We have just 12
oh,
days
really?
To go.
That is working. Sorry.
Until Election Day, a new Fox News poll showing Donald Trump cutting Hillary Clinton's lead in half as the candidates ramp up their attacks on the campaign trail. All right, officially, this
All
is
right.
Outnumbered, and I'm Sandra Smith here today, and there she is, Harris
Faulkner.
I'm here
Faulkner, for you, babe.
Host of Kennedy on Fox Business, Kennedy, former National Security Council member under Presidents Bush and Obama, Jillian Turner, and today's hashtag one lucky guy, Iraq and Afghanistan veteran and Fox News contributor, Pete Hegseth is here, and he is outnumbered. I can tell Harris is trying to figure out what was going on there because you were,
I
you
was
were
working.
Working.
I'm like, what?
And the camera was on you for a second, but that's all right.
It's live television.
That's absolutely right.
Yeah, well, and I'm sitting next to Pete, so I'm happy. Oh, you know, it's all good.
You distract me every
and
time.
And you've got your pumpkin orange
yeah,
tie and
this
socks
is my,
on.
This is my yeah.
matching
no.
socks as well.
Pumpkin fall.
Well accessorized, Texas.
Do what I can.
Well done.
Next week, 12 days? Are we 12 days out?
Unbelievable. Just
I know.
12 days. Can you wait? All right, so let's begin with this Fox News poll. It is a new one, and it finds Hillary Clinton now leading Donald Trump nationally by just 3 points, 44% to 41% in a four-way race. Last week, the Democratic nominee was up by 6 points, and 2 weeks ago, Hillary was leading by 7. All this as the candidates continue to slam each other on the trail.
He says not paying taxes makes him smart. Well, I don't know. I don't know how smart you have to be to lose $1 billion in 1 year. And besides, what kind of genius loses money running a casino, for heaven's sakes?
Here's a woman who goes home and she goes to sleep all the time. Think of it. She's got no energy whatsoever. She makes a speech for 15 minutes. She goes home, goes to bed. She has less energy than Jeb Bush.
Oh. Pete Hegseth is losing it on
oh,
the couch
I
over here.
I love it.
That
amazing
has you
political theater.
And a full belly laugh.
Yeah. Well, it is. I mean, he's making a closing argument that if you want to be strong, if you want a strong leader who's engaged, come to me. The best thing Donald Trump has going for him in these last 12 days is Hillary Clinton, is the reality of her for the next 4 years. Mm-hmm. And every voter that's had a hesitation about Trump has to walk into that ballot box and say, am I really ready for that? Or am I going to go with my gut? And that, I think, is something the Trump folks are really hoping for, is that over this period of time, they're going to walk away from Hillary Clinton if he can have and continue to show strong performance.
And they're both trying to grab some of those undecided voters out there, and I want to make sure that I let everybody know, if they don't know already, that you hadn't supported Donald Trump all along.
No.
And that you made that conversion sort of late in the game.
Yeah, no, I was a Rubio guy, and then a Cruz guy, and then I was a never Hillary guy, and then I was kind of, I don't know, I guess Trump. And today I will proudly pull the lever for Trump, because this, for me, this election's about America, and whether we save it and fight for it. It's not traditional conservatism or leftist. It's, do we have a country or not? Do we support our cops or not? Do we rebuild our military or not? Do we have borders or not? Do we stand for the national anthem or not? I mean, that's what we're talking about right now. We're having a cultural clash.
So you came to the realization that this is an unprecedented time. This is a much different election than we have seen. Harris, this polling shows this is a really tight race with 12 days to go.
Yeah, so that makes it traditional, which might be the only way that it is traditional from what we've seen this season, right?
Sure.
You interjected with what about women? Don't
know.
Any of those... No, but I heard you, so I want to bring you into the conversation here, because what Pete was listing, actually, none of that was irrespective of women. Women care about the military, the economy. So I'm curious to know why you would ask, what about women?
Oh, well, because, you know, we're talking, Pete's talking about this unprecedented host of issues that we're dealing with, and I agree, especially on the national security front. We were talking about that this morning. But how do you reconcile yourself? This is a question I've asked of myself and my girlfriends. How do you reconcile, forget about the tape even from 2 years ago, how do you reconcile his attitude towards women with all of these other issues? I think a lot of people aren't realizing this yet. Terrorism is a woman's issue. Women unfairly across the world bear the brunt
terrorism
and pay the consequences.
Terrorism is an everybody issue. Mm-hmm.
It is, but it greatly and deeply affects women to a degree that is not widely appreciated.
I would answer that just in two ways briefly. One, you don't have to own everything Donald Trump has ever done or said, or a videotape that came out 11 years ago. I don't support that. I'm not okay with that. But I'm not voting for a pastor in chief. A I'm voting for a commander in chief. And in that context,
but doesn't his attitudes towards half of the American population factor into his ability to lead the nation?
I also look to other women that are around him that have said, hey, he conducts himself professionally. And obviously he's made mistakes and we've seen those on full display. But that doesn't have to be the full content.
So let's consider the polling as it is today, that fresh Fox News poll. It's a tight race. To what do you attribute Donald Trump then shrinking that margin? Is he been staying on message? Is that what?
It's a couple things. One, people actually have a much shorter attention span for scandal than they have in even recent past presidential elections. Mm-hmm. And something, and I think, you know, a lot of this is cleverly timed by opposing campaigns where, you know, they find people who have stories and they put them before the media and the media jumps on it. But, you know, I think something that the Clinton campaign didn't bank on was that some of this would actually fade before this really crucial window. Because if you think about it, 2 weeks before the race, that's when a lot of people are really starting to tune in.
Yeah.
You know, maybe they caught one or two of the debates. And if they caught that final debate, very adeptly moderated by Fox News' own Chris Wallace, they saw what was essentially a draw that was about a lot of issues. So if Donald Trump can keep the Trumpisms to a bit of a minimum and, you know, keep the scandal and verbal controversy at bay for the next 2 weeks, he can certainly slice into that remaining lead that she's got in this poll. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, and you put it so deliciously, that short attention span for scandal. I mean, you could apply that across the board.
Yes, that's
about
not
anything.
Just for Donald Trump.
I mean,
you're right.
The champagne and on the, you know, posterior of Kim Kardashian blew up the internet, and the next day we were talking about something else. I mean, I'm not talking in
thank
a joking
you for that
form, but I mean, salaciousness, we've seen it. And we've seen
but remember how Donald Trump closed out the second debate, where he actually said, Hillary Clinton, I commend her for her stamina. So he's kind of undercutting what he's saying now. He likes to revert back to
she's
tired.
She
doesn't quit, and she is a fighter, but that's different than the specific stamina, because he says that, you know, she takes too many naps and too many days off.
All right, we'll move on. Guess what? WikiLeaks today just released a brand new batch of hacked emails. Apparently, this one shows big concern over Hillary Clinton's email scandal and a July 2015 email exchange. Clinton confidant Neera Tanden wrote to campaign chair John Podesta about her concerns over a CNN poll at a time when Hillary Clinton's trustworthy numbers were taking a hit. Tanden wrote this, quote, "Do we actually know who told Hillary she could use a private email? And has that person been drawn and quartered?" Like, whole thing is bleeping insane. Yeah, there were some cuss words in there. I tried to talk around it. Fast forward now to more than a year, and a new Fox poll finds a majority of American voters still don't trust Hillary Clinton. Here it is. A whopping 67% do not find the Democrat honest and trustworthy. This coming the very same day as another batch of emails linked appear to show Bill Clinton's aides pressuring foundation owners to give the former president business opportunities. So you have a couple of different things going on here, Pete.
Yeah, you sure do. I mean, it appears that a very small circle of people were behind the idea to do the private server, which doesn't change it, which actually should reinforce what terrible judgment she has, what a bad decision that was. That's a decision driven by Hillary Clinton to say, I don't want these communications shared with anyone. So I think it pins it even more on her. All this WikiLeaks stuff coming out, it's an unholy mix for Hillary Clinton. I mean, Trump is steadying the ship. Every day she's got to deal with a new batch. And it's not that the American people are obsessed with them, but the white noise of that in the background of you can't trust her, she plays by her own rules, the system is rigged, I think that does add up.
You know, Kennedy, it's interesting because this election cycle, Donald Trump has taken a lot of heat for not necessarily listening to people behind the scenes. This points out that some of that same heat maybe should be thrown Hillary Clinton's way, because they were trying, according to the emails that we're seeing released, to have conversations about what was right and what was wrong. Not just this batch.
Not everyone.
Previous ones, too. Not everybody.
No, but also,
I mean, but the ones that we talked about yesterday, did they think she'd get away with it? Blah, 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 blah. I mean, so I think it's interesting that those types of things really could be brought onto her.
It highlights the internal struggle and, you know, the competent people that she has around her that have an issue with the system that she's created that's really sycophantic. But the thing is, even as Neera Tanden is questioning, you know, who okayed this server, whose idea was it, you know, I bet it's Cheryl Mills.
Yeah.
And I also bet that if it's not Cheryl Mills, whoever it was is going to be a senior policy advisor in the White
House.
That means they're going to be affecting national policy. That will have a direct effect on our
moral lives, and they've already got questionable judgment that they have not sufficiently answered for.
But that, and they highlight her questionable judgment. One of the emails we looked at yesterday, it called into question her instincts and how poor her instincts are. And this is within her circle asking that question. But to your point, Kennedy, Cheryl Mills, doesn't have an official place in the campaign. But if Hillary Clinton is elected into the White House, you have to assume that one of these yes people, Cheryl Mills, would be working for the Hillary Clinton White House. So you look at these emails and you realize who she would surround herself with if she was president.
At least somebody that she would check in with. Because remember, she's had friends that she would check in with, and they weren't supposed to have access to her when she was at the State Department. So the fact that she would check in with somebody like this is well, it makes sense.
Part of what constitutes good leadership when we talk about a president, too, is not just that you never mess up, you never make a mistake, because everybody's going to do that. It's about how you take accountability and responsibility and deal with the aftermath. And what I really, what rankles me the wrong way about this was when you even, you know, after the news broke about the email server, it's the mad scramble to try and assign blame all over the place. So first it was the IT guy who was subpoenaed up on the Hill. Then it was Colin Powell who fought back against that. And now it's still always this, there's always this sort of panic to try and pin it on somebody. That's kind of what bothers me even more than the original sin, which was the decision to set up the server in the basement.
No, it's a very good point, because this has always been a campaign about a person rather than a cause. It's get Hillary Clinton to the White House, come hell or high water. But what does she stand for? I don't know. We're stronger together. I mean, what does it really mean? What is she really fighting
for?
That's
interesting, though, a person, not a cause, because it's hashtag I'm with her.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. All right, we'll move on. Remember Jonathan Gruber, the Obamacare architect, who said, quote, the stupidity of the American voter was crucial to passing the law? Well, he's back and apparently has more to say. Why he claims the law is working as designed despite skyrocketing premiums that start next year. Move the needle in this very close race. And Facebook Live will be sitting there talking. You can join us. Our handle on Facebook is Outnumbered FNC. It happens right at the top of the hour. We go from TV to online, and we have our own page at foxnews.com/outnumbered. Click on the overtime tab, a couple places you can watch. And in the meantime, if you want to talk to us, tweet, and we'll tweet you back. We'll see you soon.
Welcome back. You know who else is back? Jonathan Gruber. Yeah, he says despite the fact that Obamacare premiums will skyrocket by double digits next year, he says it's working as designed. The infamous Obamacare architect, who was caught on camera saying the stupidity of the American voter helped the bill pass, now insists surging premiums will only affect a very small fraction of consumers. In fact, he says if anything needs to be fixed at all, it should be raising the tax penalty for those who fail to buy insurance. Watch this.
Once again, there's no sense that it just has to be fixed. The law's working as designed. However, it could work better. And I think probably the most important thing experts would agree on is that we need a larger mandate penalty. We have individuals who are essentially free riding on the system. They're essentially waiting until they get sick and then getting health insurance.
Meantime, Donald Trump continuing to hammer the issue on the campaign trail, saying Obamacare was flawed from the start.
Real change begins with immediately repealing and replacing the disaster known as Obamacare. That one's not even close. And Hillary wants to double up and triple up. What a disgusting situation. And it was no good. It was no good the day it was conceived.
But Hillary Clinton has repeatedly said repealing the health care law is not the answer, and she wants to fix it instead. All right, so, Pete, here's the issue I have with what Jonathan Gruber said. Mm-hmm. He wants the federal government to force people to buy insurance. That's what the mandate is. He says the mandate is not coercive enough. People aren't being penalized enough for opting out of the system until they really need it when there's a catastrophe. A lot of people have realized that it's less expensive to pay the penalty than it is to actually get insurance, especially now when in places like Arizona, premiums spiking 116%
not to mention deductibles. Let's talk about the freedom there.
That's exactly right. And because the mind of a Jonathan Gruber, of a technocrat, is not that their designs could be wrong, but that the American voter and people are still stupid and need to be told what to do. I mean, that's the ruling class mentality.
Yeah.
And in Minnesota, premiums are up 60, 70%. You've only got one provider in most places, so one choice. And it's exactly what you
that's
get.
That's not a choice.
That's not a choice.
Yeah.
That's not freedom. And it's exactly what we said would happen. Costs go up, choice goes down, and people aren't gonna want it because they don't have the option.
And Sandra, the bottom line here is, you know, Jonathan Gruber, again, he despises the dirty working class people who are on the exchanges, those who do not receive federal subsidies. He says it's only a small sliver, when in fact there are a lot of people. Half the people who have Obamacare insurance didn't get it on the exchanges.
But to your point about people have learned that it's less expensive for them to pay the penalty and wait until there's a catastrophe to actually get the health insurance, and that his idea to fix this, I can't even believe he said it out loud, is to raise the penalty then? That's the idea of how to fix this. Donald Trump, though, while he is hitting this hard, and it's working for him, it appears to be, needs to be a little bit more specific. I don't know. This is what I read when I see all the criticism of Obamacare. We need to get rid of it and replace it. What exactly is he saying that he's going to do about
it? But repeal is not necessarily the right way to go here. I'm no defender of Obamacare, but kind of since I'm playing devil's advocate today, you can't turn around to the 20 million people who now have health insurance who didn't 2 years ago and say, we're going to renege.
Yeah, but they're not going to have it next year anyway because they aren't going to be able to afford it.
Yeah, they can't afford it.
And that's the problem. And actually, Donald Trump, if you go to the website, you can see, and he has been talking, maybe not as much in detail, but the plan is aligned with keeping what is working. You should go and read it. It is one of the things outside of foreign policy where he's a little thin on that because he says, well, I don't want to give away too many secrets. I think targets very well with Obamacare what his ideas would be.
People tease the idea of the lines around the states. Well, competition among states really does matter and does change the game. One thing, though, nefarious about this, in some ways we've always believed the left kind of wants it to fail because what they really want is single payer.
Absolutely.
What they really want
is
Medicare for all. So I think they say these things knowing it's not going to work, and they're going to come with a bigger government.
Do you think that Bill Clinton and President Obama would admit the failure of Obamacare?
Bill Clinton has
won an election if they didn't want it to fail.
No.
That's exactly what they want to happen. They want to turn health care into the VA, and that will be disastrous for the rest of the country.
Mm. Absolutely.
All right, in the final stretch of the election, Donald Trump is trotting out his face.
On another level.
Harris, I was going to go to you on this because we've been having conversations in recent days and weeks, especially since the video surfaced, that we hadn't seen or heard much from Donald Trump's children. And here we are, 12 days left, and he's got them out there back out on the trail.
Yeah, and this kicks off actually simultaneously with something else that's going on with the campaign. The Women for Trump are back out. They're in Florida today, and I think they go to North Carolina and then Ohio. And so from talking with the campaign, I can tell you that this is in concert, and they are aware of the criticism that they've waited a long time. But I wanted to piggyback off of something that Jillian said about how much women do or don't care about lewd comments and that sort of thing. 63% in recent polling of women said that is not going to affect the way that they vote and that they will be voting for Donald Trump in this particular poll when asked about whether the videotape with the lewd comments mattered and some of the other things. It's interesting. We always talk about the economy. It really does come down to that. And this timing of the news about Obamacare is a gift to this particular campaign
right now. And let's go back to the second-to-last debate. It was the second of the general election debates, second of the three. And the last question, they were asked to say something complimentary about each other. And even Hillary Clinton was complimenting Donald Trump's children and the way they have come up. So will this help him?
Well, what better compliment? Yes. I mean, more kids, please, because I think they are a great demonstration of a father and a family and of somebody who clearly values his kids. And they're great spokesmen for him. So I think there should be even more of this, especially women, Ivanka and others, that can get out there and attest to who he is in public and in private, that he doesn't have a public and a private position like Hillary Clinton does. He's respectful. So I think it's all good, and they should keep rolling.
Well, this helps soften his image.
Absolutely. I think all the children do a great job, particularly Ivanka. I think you've seen her in a spate of ads recently because she's so well-spoken, and she connects with people very easily. I went to ballet school with her here in New York growing up, and we shared a part when you're in the Nutcracker. So I have a little connection.
Pull the tape.
At Lincoln Center?
Pull the tape.
Yeah,
that's
awesome. We were alternates.
Cool.
We shared a part 1 year. So kind of knew her as a kid. She was very sweet. But I think they do a great job for him on the campaign trail. Absolutely. I think they should be out there every day between now and then.
So will it help, Kennedy?
Yeah, I absolutely think it does. And the fact that you're talking about his family and his children being well-spoken and not about scandal, that bodes well for him in coming polls. Also, J.P. Morgan Chase says there's a 1 in 3 chance we're going to be in a recession next year. Mm-hmm. And he is considered better at handling the economy than Hillary Clinton. So if he stays in those two lanes, it will be better for the last 2 weeks of his campaign.
And to your point, I mean, a lot of people haven't been paying attention. And when, you know, we all judge at some level, when you see kids that are out of control, or you look at the parents, right? I think America will look at these kids and say, hey, what a great batch. That must reflect well on Mr. Trump.
The Women for Trump, by the way, is run by Donald Trump's daughter-in-law, Laura Trump. And so you've got even extended family in on this that you'll be seeing too. All right, new questions of media bias. After Donald Trump took some time off the campaign trail to attend the opening of his new hotel in D.C. yesterday, CNN's Dana Bash asked him a question that did not go over so well Tuesday night, and no one questioned her about that. Meanwhile, the Democratic nominee had something to say about Trump's hotel detour as well. Watch.
I was struck today that Donald Trump is actually paying more attention to his business than to the campaign. That's his choice, but we're going to keep working really hard to reach as many voters as possible.
Can I take that for a second?
Oh, please, please.
Because it absolutely is his choice, and he would be criticized by the employees who count on him to have those companies thrive so that they get a paycheck every week, okay? So he has an obligation as a business owner to make sure that those businesses are thriving. It doesn't mean he just sets it all aside because he's running for president. He does have an obligation and responsibility there.
Can I ask you, too, because you have interviewed so many CEOs and leaders of companies on the Fox Business Network. It is not out of character for somebody to be also looking out for their brand while they do other things. You've interviewed people. Bloomberg ran for office. You didn't see the
As
Bloomberg
the head of a major publicly traded company, your number one obligation is to your shareholders. The board of directors, your obligation is to your shareholders. So in the case of Donald Trump, he has a lot of people who count on him and families that count on him to make sure that those businesses are thriving. So I will always defend somebody who is making sure that their businesses
are sound. And by the way, he can't, or rather, Hillary Clinton can't have it both ways. You know, yesterday she's attacking him because she says he lost $1 billion in a year and failed at running casinos. And she said, how can anyone who runs a casino lose money? And then she criticizes him for going and servicing one of his businesses. So she really has to choose her line of attack there. And it also goes to show, and this is one of my biggest pet peeves that I have with politicians, they know nothing, not only about business and the economy, but they don't know how to run a business.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, a lot of what we talked about this campaign season, though, was her earning. And speeches that she's given, and her own income.
For talking.
Yeah.
And then I think this is great politics. This is exactly what he should do. Oh, by the way, I run this multi-billion dollar company, and we build hotels that are under budget and on time, which is exactly what he said. No, listen, I mean, this is the right contrast. And just because it's not a campaign stop doesn't mean there weren't 40 cameras there broadcasting the entire event across the country.
There were.
So you can still campaign, and I think it's a great campaign event.
You know, some of the criticism, though, came for Donald Trump because Governor Pence was out on the trail in Utah, a state that arguably some were saying he might not be able to win with the electoral vote count. So it looked as though Donald Trump were not working while Mr. Pence was, except for the fact that he had two rallies later.
Was working.
Well, I think also a lot of American voters, or certainly some, I'll speak for myself, are not used to seeing a presidential candidate that's also, you know, like a major CEO of a huge corporation. And there's a lot of kind of trepidation around that, right? You have to remind people that this is not, you know, a sub-Saharan African country. It doesn't mean our leaders are corrupt because they also have successful businesses that they're going to run while they're politicians.
Some probably wish that President Obama would go back to the White House and do his job rather than campaigning for Hillary Clinton when we have so much going on.
I've been reading your Twitter. And I've been reading mine. A lot of people are wondering, are we paying for that as taxpayers as he does that? Okay, a top GOP congressman seems to be hopping back onto the Trump train. And House Oversight Chair Jason Chaffetz, who's been our hashtag a couple of times, is also warning that if Hillary Clinton does win...
Republican Congressman Jason Chaffetz appears to be back on the Trump train after previously yanking his endorsement over crude remarks the GOP nominee once made about women. Now the House Oversight Committee chairman says he will vote for Trump after all. because Hillary, he says, and this is quote, says she's that bad for the country. All this, as Chaffetz says, he has years of investigations planned if Clinton wins the presidency. He's telling the Washington Post, Chaffetz says, and I quote, "We've got 2 years worth of material already lined up. She has 4 years of history at the State Department, and it ain't good. She's not getting a clean slate. It's not like the State Department was bending over backwards to help us understand what was going on. We've got document destruction. We've got their own rogue system. We've got classified information out the door. We've got their foundation doing things. Who knows what?" Kennedy, I'm going to go to you. First of all, is it harmful for candidates to be off the Trump train and then on the Trump train and then back on? I mean, what does that say?
It makes you look wishy-washy. Yeah, make up your mind. You know, it's like, and then if you're off, stay off. But it's interesting because he, I think, is in a unique position because he's from Utah, and that's a state that's very close. Mm-hmm. That Evan McMullen, the independent candidate mm-hmm. that, you know, a lot of conservatives are backing, he could win Utah. So I think by Chaffetz saying that he's going to vote for Trump, I think that that is a signal to some of his fellow Republicans in his home state that in order to beat Hillary, that's what they have to do.
I think it's
more about that.
That's such a great point that Kennedy makes because McMullen is selling himself as the true conservative on the ticket who is not necessarily aligned with the political party. And so if you can scoop up some of those people who would like to maybe join in with other Republicans, maybe it would work if Chaffetz says he's voting for him. The only problem I have with Chaffetz, though, with regard to what he's going to do after she, you know, goes forward, whether she's in office or not, it hasn't worked so far. How many hearings have we had on all these things? So if there's a course correction that he or other Republican lawmakers would like to make in order to get justice with what they see are problems with Hillary Clinton, then I would say the American people are all for it. But right now, I don't know if it's nothing other than a non-issue. I think they just want you to fix the economy and do a few other things.
Yeah, no, Jillian, how would that play out if they were to continue to investigate a President Clinton?
How would it play out if she loses and then they drop the whole thing? In a sense, that's even worse for the Republicans' optics because it's like underwrites this notion from the left that this has all been a political hack job, which, by the way, that statement reeked of to me. I mean, this is the same guy who, when he dropped off the Trump train a few weeks ago, went on national television every single day and talked about how it was like he was one of the party ralliers who were saying, "Forget the presidential nominee. We got to save our own butts." Mm-hmm. So everybody, do what you need to do in order to save yourself.
Been here
and
many
now he's
times.
Back on.
And every time he's here, he makes the point: this is my job. This isn't political. Whether or not we decide to continue investigations or add more or do more, this is our job. If there are still unanswered questions, then we're going to ask them. But for him to say that we're going to do this if she becomes president, it makes it look very political.
Do you think they would do it? No, you've sat with them. Do you think they would continue the investigations if she doesn't win?
They should if they still need to.
Of course they should. I don't know. But again, even if they do, if they don't course correct, what difference will it make?
Okay.
It has not worked thus far, although it would look like it's a genuine effort.
Sure.
And maybe they can come up with a new way to align all of this evidence.
But this is the point that I brought up to him. Pick your battles. Pick your battles with her. Because I think if she doesn't win the presidency and she's really broken the law, you have to go after her for the most egregious lawbreaking. Mm-hmm. And that's what they have to do if she becomes president. You shouldn't impose a double standard there either. So if she's mm-hmm. done something so bad that you have to set a precedent for the future, do it regardless of whether or not she ascends to
and
the Oval
Throne. If you're doing it for the American people, you will continue the effort regardless of who's in the Oval Office.
The nuance that I caught with what you said, though, Kennedy, was pick your battles in the sense, pick the ones that have the most evidence. Don't just throw a basket at it, if you will. That's such a weird word this season. But you know what I mean. Don't just throw a bunch if she should become president and then hope some stuff sticks.
Yeah. No, and I agree with what you said.
I needed like a different word other than basket. Like, I don't know.
Bucket.
Okay.
Bushel.
No.
Bushel.
Scandal.
Bushel's not used enough, by the way.
It really isn't. Thank you.
Bushel. Oh, that's a good one.
We're going to bring it back. It's very biblical. All right. Donald Trump is doubling down on comments he made in the last debate about the need for an element of surprise in our military strategy. Well, and he's not holding back in his response to a military expert who says Trump's got it all wrong. We'll discuss. Stick around.
Friday evening. leave in just a moment. Let's go to my friend Jenna Lee with what's coming up in the second hour of Happening Now. Hey, Jenna.
Hey there, Harris. Next hour, we're awaiting Donald Trump. A Donald Trump rally, in fact, expected to kick off in a few minutes in Springfield, Ohio. Polls in Ohio show a tight race in the key battleground state with a slight edge for the Trump ticket. We're going to take you there live. Plus, Chris Wallace will join us with more on that. Also, Hillary Clinton boarded her campaign plane last hour. She's on her way to North Carolina for a campaign rally with First Lady Michelle Obama, who has become one of her strongest surrogates this season. And Republican Vice Presidential candidate Mike Pence headlined a rally in Omaha last hour, but he's expected in a fundraiser tonight in New York that could raise as much as $1 million for the Trump campaign. So a lot to watch coming up top of the hour.
All right, we'll be watching. Thank you.
Whatever happened to the element of surprise, okay? We announced we're going after Mosul. I've been reading about going after Mosul now for about, how long is it, Hillary? 3 months? These people have all left. They've all left. The element of surprise. Douglas MacArthur, George Patton, spinning in their graves when they see the stupidity of our country.
Donald Trump's comments at the last debate sparking criticism now from a military expert, a former dean of the Army War College, telling the New York Times, quote, "What this shows is Trump doesn't know a damn thing about military strategy." The Republican nominee was asked about that on Good Morning America, where he doubled down on his original comments and took a dig at that military expert.
I'll teach him a couple of things.
Ooh. So he says it's dangerous to broadcast your plans in advance. But here's something else to chew on for a second. He tweeted on Sunday, this is like, I think, 3 or 4 days into the ongoing offensive against ISIS in Mosul, that it was turning out to be a disaster. Well, the news flash for Mr. Trump is that when you're president, you don't get to declare defeat while you've got troops on the ground, Americans out in harm's way, because that is actually deadly. Yep. And that really upset me about these comments. And I think that he needs to reflect on that a little bit.
That is fair criticism.
Not to sound like a school teacher.
That is fair criticism. Not only would you not forecast defeat, you wouldn't forecast victory either, because you have men and women on the ground.
It's actually deadly.
We are playing such a critical role in what's happening in Mosul. ISIS is actually running out the back door that we created for them. Now they're going to nest in Raqqa, where they have been, those scorpions. Maybe we'll hit them from the air. But I think that's fair criticism.
No, I mean, you've served. Imagine being out on the battlefield and the commander-in-chief is talking about defeat.
In the past, I've been highly critical. In 2007, during the Iraq surge, you had Harry Reid and everyone declaring the war lost as our warfighters were surging into Baghdad and changing the game. I mean, that is not acceptable. But on this comment, I think what Trump is saying is he's reflecting a sentiment amongst a lot in the military that we've got political generals, that we forecast our strategy, that we fight with one hand tied behind our back, that the military has become a social petri dish as opposed to a warfighting institution. That's what he's talking about more than
he should say that.
Okay, can I ask you what you're talking about?
No, but I think that's the sentiment
Donald
that he's talking
about.
He says it differently.
I just want a point of clarification here, because Donald Trump's saying don't broadcast your plans ever. But General Robert Scales said, actually, this is called a cordon strategy, and you have to broadcast this because we're trying to save a million civilian lives so people don't get caught up and, you know, you create more casualties. And you have to, section by section, get to the heart of the city and isolate the people that you're fighting, and also create a hallway for refugees to get out.
I mean, there's also a big difference between broadcasting your ground strategy, your battle strategy, and broadcasting a general strategy. You're trying to sell the American people, the voters, that national security and terrorism is the most dire threat we face today. Well, you know what? You owe the voters a decently thought-out plan that tells us, give us a roadmap for where you're going to go.
Voters decide what they think about his military strategy at this point, because Clinton said his disrespect for our military knows no bounds. What do you, I mean, you're, as I pointed out earlier, a convert and now support Donald Trump. What are you hearing from your...
Look at the military members, look at the vets in all the polls. They're overwhelmingly for Trump. They know what the Clinton years look like for our military, the way the military was treated. They remember that. The disrespect that Hillary Clinton has shown to Secret Service agents and others, it's well documented. They don't want that. And in Donald Trump, I think they see someone who will stand broadly and salute and be proud of those troops and unleash them. So yes, there's definitely a strategy to let some people, military, you will let people know to minimize civilian casualties. The frustration folks would have with that is when we drop leaflets on oil tankers in, against ISIS because we don't want to bomb those and their civilian casualties. They feel like we're fighting politically correct wars. And that
but
Trump
we have
would
done
stop
that in our
that.
History before, though, when we were getting ready to drop something from the sky. We did drop leaflets letting people know for the reasons that Kennedy was pointing out so that people could get out of the way. Which
it's a
is
sense
different
that it's
than
excessive.
The political side that you're making.
Yeah.
All right. Well, any moment now, Donald Trump, he is scheduled to take to the stage in the battleground state of Ohio. With only 12 days until we go to the polls. Have we mentioned that this show? Yeah, a few times. 12 days? 12 days, everybody. Ooh. We will take you to him live when he begins. And this White House campaign has got emotions running very high, if you haven't noticed, sometimes causing high tension among family and friends. But never fear, Hillary Clinton's got the remedy. A big old national dance party. Yep, that'll do it.
I'll be there.
Song of the summer. I promised on Twitter there would be a dance party. All right, well, the 2016 race leading to a dance revolution. We're not making this up, people. In an interview with syndicated radio show The Breakfast Club, Hillary Clinton says, we need a, quote, national dance party to heal the nation. Listen.
That was the other part of that clip. Did you hear the beginning of that interview?
Covered it yesterday.
We're talking to black voters. I'm very aware.
So much pandering.
It's a little painful, but I agree.
You would never say no to dance.
I agree to the idea that I have friends on both sides of the aisle, and we can fight, and we can have arguments about policy. We can have arguments about emotional stuff. But at the end of the day, everybody wants the same thing, which is a stronger America, a better America.
Shave your tail feather.
You know,
everyone
like, there's nothing wrong with having a little fun in the election season.
Some organized fun by Hillary Clinton, a Hillary Clinton-managed prom that we can all get to go to with lots of rules and regulations.
We had so many dance parties in the White House window.
I wish we could ask a former MTV VJ what she thinks about a national dance party.
Baby, I'd love to dance. I think it's fantastic.
I love
to dance and
give us some neck
pants
because it's Friday.
it is Friday. And I like seeing my friend Charlamagne the God there. You know, and he's asked her some tough questions throughout this political season, but unfortunately they wanted to keep it all light for her birthday party and blah blah blah. But yeah, she panders to people. She just finds her audience and says whatever she thinks they want to hear, which is problematic because you have a candidate that a lot of people find to be very inauthentic.
Or she just loves to dance.
No chance.
Harris loves an excuse to dance. I mean, what's wrong with this idea, Harris?
I do love any excuse to shake my tail feather. But I will say, what's wrong with having some positivism? I mean, it can come from anybody. I kind of take it along.
Let's have real positivism. I'm all for positive, not fake national dance parties by Hillary.
You don't think Hillary can dance?
It's really a line she thought of. I'd like to see that tape if somebody's got it.
Oh, she danced on Ellen. It was horrific.
Yes. Yeah.
She
danced
on Ellen.
She
did the
dance?
Nay-nay.
Yeah. No.
Oh, yeah.
No.
Did she dance?
The camera's off.
Yeah. I tell you.
She dances and Harris sings.
They'd be outnumbered over time.
We need a national karaoke party.
Right. Yeah.
I like
Pete
that.
Hexa, thank you.
Yeah,
thank you
baby.
Always good to have you, sir.
Yeah.
And Jillian, awesome to have you here as
thank
well.
Thank you.
Would you guys come karaoke with me and Sandra?
Oh, gosh.
Are you kidding?
We better go. We're staying right here for Outnumbered Overtime on the web. This conversation continues. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/outnumberedFNC. We're back on TV tomorrow at noon Eastern. The dance party starts now. Happening now starts.